You know, when you don't have a path in your mind, the question is, how do you progress? For me, it was always one step at a time. And then after a while, you're sort of looking around and you're saying, I'm as good as they are. And then after a while, it's like, I'm a little better than they are. And it's sort of, you're ready for the next step. My name is Sue Wessler, and I'm a professor of genetics here at UC Riverside. I was born in the Bronx. Neither one of my parents went to college. They wanted desperately for me to be a medical doctor. I was in high school from 1966 until 1970, which was really the height of the Vietnam War protests. The other thing going on at that time were sort of women's rights. Girls weren't allowed to wear pants to school. And so we had a little protest. Within a couple of days, we were allowed to wear pants to school. And my best friend at the time, Barbara Levine, we would go over to her house and we would smoke pot, eat all the frozen food from the refrigerator, and her mom would come home and say, what happened to the fried shrimp? And we'd have to make up some kind of story. We went to state universities. I went to Stony Brook. I was pre-med. It would be these massive classrooms, and it wouldn't be doing science. And I had really gotten to love to actually do science in the labs, to do experiments. So I'm like, oh, I could apply and get into much better graduate schools than I could into medical school. So I got into Cornell and started in 1975. When I started graduate school at Cornell in biochemistry, Barbara was in nursing school at Syracuse. I was driving her home in December of 1975. So I dropped her off at New Paltz. The next day I got a phone call saying that she was in a car accident and she basically died instantly. That was one of the events in my life that really changed me. That could have been me, and what would I have to show for it? And so I started taking graduate school quite seriously after that. I met my future husband in graduate school. This is the two-body problem in science, that when you're with somebody who's a scientist, you have to find two positions. He found something in the Baltimore, Washington area, so I had to find something there. And I knew that there was a lab at the Carnegie Institution that was doing the sort of work I wanted to do, which was eukaryotic gene expression. Nina Fedoroff, she said to me, you know, I'm working on maize transposable elements. Transposable elements are DNA that can move around the chromosome. And I didn't want to sound like an idiot. I just said, oh, of course I knew that. And that's how I started working on what I've been working on since 1980. I got elected to the National Academy of Sciences at 44, which is a very young age to get elected. So I started working with Barbara McClintock's transposable elements, but I was also working on the studies of a professor at University of Wisconsin named Oliver Nelson. And he was a very, very quiet man. And what I didn't realize is he had a lot of power in the National Academy. And when the time came, he nominated me. And that's really what it comes down to. I mean, you have to be noticed. You know, at the University of Georgia, we had virtually nobody who was a National Academy member. And slowly, I just started becoming more involved with the National Academy, getting to know people. And then in 2010, I got a phone call asking if I'd be willing to run to serve as Home Secretary. So I agreed to run, and to my surprise, I was elected. So what attracted me to the job of Home Secretary is that this job is sort of the head of the membership office. I thought at the time that the membership, and not just me, but many, many people, many women thought that the membership needed more diversity, that we needed more people of color, more, especially at that time, women. Because more and more women were becoming senior scientists, and it's senior scientists, academic scientists, who are the path to eventually being elected to the National Academy of Sciences. And I can say that over the 12 years, we have dramatically increased the diversity. And I think that's important because it's prestigious to become a member of the National Academy of Sciences, and it's prestigious on your campus. What that means is if we have more people of color, more women who are important people on campus, they serve as role models for students that look like them. I remember one time a student asked me, as a woman, why did you succeed? First thing is you need to marry somebody who takes your career seriously. You need to plan to have time for your family and time for your lab. All my friends, my colleagues, my female friends who are scientists, and not only did all of us run successful labs, but we had kids. And it's basically that we don't take any shit. If something doesn't sound right, or if we feel like we're being discriminated against or whatever, you know, we'll just say it. I had no idea that I could do science as a career. And here I am, 45 years into it, having had just an absolute wonderful time.
That's good.
It's always smile.
I like this.
Do you want me to do it again?
Yeah, that's good.
One more time.